Welcome to Questions for Christians. This is a TV show where a Christian and an atheist have a friendly and interesting discussion. Today I'm going to be talking about Kent Hovind's tax issues. Kent Hovind is a young earth creationist, and he spent 10 years or nearly 10 years in jail for tax issues, and he's been out for a year now. He just recently had an anniversary. And he's back at it. He's back at the Young Earth Creation and Evangelism business. My guest today is going to be Robert Baty. He's a person who's been watching this, and he's been trying to grab the attention of Kent Hovind in order to debate him, because Kent Hovind is making all these claims like he was falsely imprisoned and all this. And so Robert would like to be a counterpoint and to basically say that what Kent is saying is not true. So my guest today is Robert Baty. And Robert, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Where are you calling in from? What city, state?
Fort Collins, Colorado.
Okay. Welcome to Portland, Oregon area. I'm going to give a short introduction to who I am, and then I'll give you a short introduction to who you are, just for people who have never heard of who you are. And then we're going to talk more about who you are, but just for a general overview. So to give a little overview of who I am, I was a born-again evangelical Christian for a long time. I was raised a Roman Catholic, and when I became, after college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian. And then I remained one and grew in the faith until I was 49 years old, when I left the faith, became an atheist. While I was working, since 1984, I've got a bachelor's in electronics engineering technology. I've been working in the computer field since 1984. And while I was working in the computer field, I also got a master's in ministry degree from Luther Rice Seminary in Lithuania, Georgia. That was in 2007. And then in 2009, I became an atheist, because I debated atheists and I came to believe that their worldview makes better sense of the world. Since then, I've written a book. It's for sale on Amazon.com. It's called Modern Science and Philosophy: Destroy Christian Theology. And in that book, I explain why I think it no longer makes sense to believe the Christian theology, especially in light of modern science and philosophy. And that's basically the reasons why I left the faith. People leave the faith for different reasons, and these are to remind me why I left, and also to help other people, because a lot of people ask me why I left. I also have a YouTube channel where I do these, where I post all my debates. I do a lot of debates in the Portland area and discussions with Christian evangelists and apologists. The YouTube channel is called Sec Hummer, which is short for secular humanism. So with that, Robert, welcome to the show, and I'd like to give you a minute to just give a brief background as to who you are.
Thank you very much. I'm a Christian, a member of the Church of Christ, a longtime member. I'm currently just an old man with a keyboard, as I like to tell people. But in 2005, I retired with 38 years of creditable service under the civil service system. Federal civil service system. Most of that time was spent with the Internal Revenue Service. And for many years, starting around 1990, I became involved in a critical analysis of the young earth creation science claims of various sorts, and had quite an interesting, in my opinion, history with that.
Okay. Let's talk more about who you are and what your relationship with Hovind is. I heard Kent say that you are an undercover IRS agent trying to persecute him still, I guess. What kind of accusations have you heard from him about you? So you say you're just a retired IRS agent, right?
Right.
And so you don't work for the IRS whatsoever in any way now?
I retired after 20 years as an appeals officer. I started as what they call an office auditor, was in review staff for a little while, and then spent the rest of my career as an appeals officer. I was never what they call an agent.
And how long ago did you retire?
2005.
Okay, so
walked out and never looked back.
So we're looking at 11 years ago. You've never had any payroll. You've never been paid for anything by the IRS to do anything since then.
No, and I think Kent knows that. I think his people know that. They have made all sorts of accusations against me.
Well, when you say you think he knows that, you're basically saying he's, you know, bald-faced liar there. He's just boldly lying about that?
Well, you know, I've been on the Internet for a long time now, and I would often see people accusing other people of lying, and I tried to avoid getting down to that level. But
right,
Kent
right.
Hovind is a special case, and some of the things are so, to me, obvious and egregious that I don't mind raising the issue.
So what else has he said about you other than you're an undercover agent? What other things has he said to cast aspersions on you, I guess?
Well, it's not so much about me, although you can research what he and his people say about me. And I think he relies a lot on his people to do his dirty work so that he can try to keep his hands clean. But it also has to do what he says about his cases and his tax problems. And his refusal to accept responsibility for his part in his problems.
Okay, in this section, though, let's just talk about your relationship with him. So you told me that you had some directed dealings with him. Can you tell us how close were you? How much did you talk to him about things? And was it verbal or just written or what?
It was written. I don't think I've ever talked to him on the phone or seen him or met him in person. But his people came to me with his permission, I think it was back in 2013, and they wanted Kent to talk directly to me. That was when he was in prison.
And they picked you because you were already writing some critical things about him? Is that why they chose you?
Well, I think it had something to do with the fact that at that point in time, I had gotten Peter J. Riley interested in covering the case and providing some Forbes publicity, good or bad. You know, they say there is no such thing as bad publicity.
Forbes magazine, that was?
Yes.
Okay.
And so if you read through the correspondence, which is available online, you'll see that background that Kent seem to think, and his people seem to think, it would be good because of the Forbes connection to have a discussion. And I think later Peter J. Riley even had contact directly with Kent while he was in prison, the details of which Peter, being a good journalist and all that, does not reveal as far as I know. And I think it was rather short-lived. But mine went on for, our direct correspondence involved, I think, 22 emails.
Between you and Kent?
Yes.
Okay.
There were some between me and his people before that, and some between me and his people after that, and then the 22 between Kent and myself, which I guess works out to 11 each.
As you were talking with him in your emails, could you kind of sense the relationship was getting tenser and tenser before it broke off? And it broke off on his side, is that what you're saying?
Yes, it wasn't too belligerent at all. We got along just fine. He apparently was wanting to do something, and I was wanting to have a conversation, and he didn't like the idea that I might think he was guilty. He claimed to know what the law was and didn't want to be told what the law was. He said he knew that, and when I started pressing him to deal with the details, that's when he cut things off. He also, that was during the time when his personal income tax case was about to be decided by the tax court, And he told me in that correspondence he didn't know anything about that. And that was shortly after his wife's case had been decided by the tax court, a couple of 3 months earlier, I think. And he told me he didn't know anything about that either. So I informed him about that, and eventually it prompted him to do something about his own personal income tax case, which was eventually decided by the tax court, and he appealed and lost on the appeal. But when I started answering his questions and then asking him to answer my questions, he just cut it off.
Okay.
And I got a message saying, you've been cut off.
Do you think there was, all right, so let's wrap up this section about who you are and what your relationship with Kent was. Is there anything we forgot to say about that you can summarize?
Well, I think it's somewhat speculative, but from my perspective, I've had a lot of influence on how Kent has been handling certain of his ongoing problems, which I think is a good thing. I don't think he necessarily admit to it, but it's not a case that I'm some stranger he never heard of and doesn't know about. And thinks it's some kind of subversive government agent out to get him. I think he knows better. We've been doing this dance a long time, and he's got his game plan, and I'm still waiting for him to come out and face me, or send a champion out to face me to discuss some of these important public issues.
Now, did his supporter or him call you a pedophile, or is it the other way around? They said you were accusing them of being pedophiles?
I don't mind raising certain types of sensitive issues involving Kent, because his people, one of the first things some of them started accusing me of as being a homosexual, and recently they've accused me of filing false police reports and being under investigation and all sorts of things. And they do that quite cowardly and anonymously. They are not the type of persons that want to face someone they're accusing and deal with the accusations directly. They like to sit back undercover and make their accusations, and never can you get them to come out and deal with the details.
So they're trying to distract things. You say, like, look, here's a crime he did, and they respond back, oh, well, you're a homosexual, huh? So, you know, what, you can't be trusted. That's the game they're playing, try to bring it under a personal attack.
Over time, there's been a lot of accusations, and part of it, in my opinion, it's part of their tactics, well thought out in advance, to talk about anything except Kent's issues.
Okay.
And so they have attacked more viciously than they ever did me. They have attacked viciously his judge, his prosecutors, the investigators. They've attacked anybody they can that was involved in the prosecution of Kent.
Okay.
The internet's full of that stuff where they've done that. And you try to get Kent to come out and deal with his own problems, which are what the issues are, and he won't do it.
Okay, so now we'll go into the second section. And this is basically the main issue, I think. Let me know if I'm wrong, but it's all about the structuring, pretty much.
Well, I'm willing to accept Kent's own statement. You can quibble about the subjective evaluation of the various issues, but Kent has said that in order to properly understand his legal problems, you need to understand about structuring.
Okay, so let me just introduce this subject. So we're going to talk about structuring. Kent is not on the show, so in a way, I'm acting as the devil's advocate here. I was talking to my kid before the show. I asked him if he knew what devil's advocate was, and he never heard the term. He's going to be going in the eighth grade. So just to explain it to the TV audience, because there's some people who maybe don't know about that. Basically, a devil's advocate is somebody who can argue for the other side, and it doesn't matter what the topic is. It could be anything, like ice cream is the best thing in the world, and the devil's advocate would say, like, well, have you considered this about ice cream? And, you know, or you could say ice cream is the worst thing in the world, and you could say, well, have you considered this for ice cream? And I think the funny thing, there's three ironic things about me being a devil's advocate for Kent Hovind. One is, I don't believe in the devil. I don't think he exists, but it doesn't matter because it's a metaphor anyway. The second one is, atheists are sometimes caricatured as evil and devils. So here I am, the devil's advocate, playing my part as a devil, you know, the atheist. So that's kind of funny. And the third thing is, me being devil's advocate, I'm also the advocate for Kent Hovind. So that means Kent Hovind is a devil in this case. So anyway, I thought that was interesting. There's three ways that's ironic. So why don't you bring up the charge? I don't know, how should we start? Maybe explain what structuring is and then what Hovind did?
I'll lay a little background.
Okay.
In 2006, a grand jury returned an indictment against Kent, which included 45 charges of structuring, which is a financial crime. And there is a banking law and regulations that explain what that is. And in Kent's case, what he was doing was withdrawing just under $10,000 in cash on a regular basis in order to keep the bank from having to file a report on the transaction. Banks are required to file a report on cash transactions of over $10,000.
Because that's a sign of drug dealers and things like that when you're dealing with cash like that.
Not necessarily so. It could be a sign of many things. But
that's the reason why they have the laws, because a lot of people that are doing illegal things, they do it with cash and they're moving.
Well, Kent misrepresents the foundation of the law, in my opinion. He says a lot about it, but as is typical of so many of his claims, he doesn't back it up. For instance, he says the law was intended to catch drug dealers. Well, that's too convenient for Kent to use to lie about his problem. The law, as I understand it, was designed as an enforcement tool against people, even tax-cheating Baptist preachers, who use our financial institutions in furtherance of their criminal activity. But in the wisdom of Congress, they made structuring a standalone crime so that if you structure transactions to keep the bank from reporting it, that's a crime in and of itself.
So basically the banks are on the lookout for large cash flows, and $10,000 is one popular limit. I heard you say that they have to report those, and there are lots of reports, and there's a lot of innocent uses of $10,000 cash. Like if I wanted to buy a truck, I might withdraw $10,000 cash, no big deal. Hovind is basically trying to pay his employees by cash and not by check because he's trying to hide information from the government with taxes. And so he knows about this reporting thing for $10,000. So he's withdrawing slightly under $10,000 to try not to get the attention of the government. But the government's smarter than that and they can see what he's doing. So technically he violated the structuring because he's pulling out large chunks of cash. And when you ask him what he's doing it for, it's obviously why he's doing it. He's doing it to pay his employees, and he's not recording any of that stuff. Is that all right?
His actual records will probably never be generally known because he's destroyed a lot of them. And he can tell his story the way he wants to tell them, like, I took the money out and paid my bills. Well, no telling what all he used that money for. I'm sure he spent some of them on legitimate business expenses as well as personal expenses, and he spent a lot of it on buying property. he acquired lots and lots of property there in Pensacola. And over the years, as was testified in his trial, he was running over $1 million a year through his operations and not filing any tax return. He's even bragged about not filing any personal tax returns. And so,
you know, I just heard him on a video today, and I think it's a recent video, but maybe it's not a recent one, but it was since he got out, and he said, you know what, I'm accused of not paying my taxes, but I pay all taxes. I pay sales tax. If I buy jewelry, I pay jewelry tax. I pay all taxes. That's what he was claiming. And so now you're saying something different, that he did not pay income tax for many years.
Depending on how you want to classify things and characterize things, I think he lies about that by omission, if nothing else. One of the things he seems not to want to do is talk about his personal income tax problems. And I think one reason for that is he doesn't want to publicly have it widely broadcast that what he really claims is that our income tax law doesn't apply to him.
Yes, I mean, there's a whole group of people out there that say there is no law that says you have to pay taxes and it's unconstitutional to pay taxes, and so you don't have to pay taxes, and you know, the government cannot force you to pay taxes. Is that right? There's a whole movement out there, and he sees people probably getting away with it, so he tried to get away with it too, and he's saying he's a citizen of heaven and not of earth and that kind of stuff.
He's got his own scheme about all of that, but I would like to see him come out and deal with that explicitly. You know, it's one thing for him to say, under the law, I have certain allowable exemptions or benefits. It's another to say, personal income tax doesn't apply to me. I pay all the taxes I owe. However, where that issue is in dispute, as it was in his case, we have a way to resolve that, and we don't resolve it based on Kent Hovind's say-so.
So are you saying for taxes he didn't pay, those are state income taxes and federal both that he didn't pay?
Well, there's no income tax in Florida. It's federal.
Okay.
Federal, personal federal income tax.
And then I think I read one place or one time that he said, I'm a citizen of heaven, not of the United States. I revoke my U.S. citizenship because I'm a citizen of heaven. Have you heard that?
Yes, I think you can look that up on the internet, as well as his attempt to void his Social Security number. So he's gone through what generally is called the sovereign citizen scheme of claiming, you know, he's not a citizen and the law doesn't apply to him. And his co-conspirator, Paul John Hansen, is big in that area. He's served his time as backup in Nebraska, where he's got quite a history of giving the local authorities fits over his sovereign citizen claims. But that's part of it.
Let's talk about that a little bit, because I heard him on a video too. He was going off on this sovereign citizen. He goes, you know what? We have these words in English, and some words have multiple meanings and stuff. And I think I know what a sovereign citizen is, but in the courts, they redefine all these things. It's like, what is sovereign? I think only God is sovereign. What is that supposed to mean? And so what exactly is a sovereign citizen? So what's this all about? Is this about him trying to revoke his status as a USA citizen and trying to claim he's a child of God instead or something like that?
I think it's part of the game Kent likes to play with words. When issues are brought up, it's a way of diverting attention away from his problems. He'll tell you, I'm not sure I know what a citizen is. And, you know, Obama's not really the president of the United States. He's the president of some corporation called the United States. Stuff like that. So you need really, in my opinion, some kind of formal way to approach the issues, get Kent to come out and be honest about them, and try to limit his ability to put on a performance and evade the issue and divert attention away from the issue. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's like Bill Clinton saying, it depends on your definition of the word is. You know, you start playing word games like that. And Hillary Clinton's doing these kind of same things.
And, if he wants to play that game, they can be played within some limits. And it may be helpful to get him to publicly, to some extent, put on that performance. He owes millions in personal income tax, and he hardly ever will you see him even mention it.
Well, you said you mean federal income tax?
Right, personal federal income tax.
Okay. Yeah, okay, not state, right?
And that's...
So he still has a big tax bill, you're saying?
Yeah,
I mean back taxes.
As far as I know, it runs into the millions, and he's given no indication that he's paid it down.
Wow, and I was just gonna bring up another topic about his wife and divorce and all that stuff. Maybe we could talk about that later too. But I mean, why she's leaving him, because I mean, I'm just imagining her saying, "Why are you still digging yourself deeper? Let's get over this and." He's saying, no, I'm going to fight it, and wonder if she's had enough of that.
Well, I think she has. She'd been counseled for a long time that she may need to separate from him, but she apparently has religious principles and thought she needed to stand by her man. But after he got out and it became obvious that he was unrepentant and was going back to his old ways and old theories and old practices, that, it wasn't going to work for her.
Yeah, I think I heard just today on Kent's video, he was saying, today would have been his such and such anniversary with his wife, but, they were separated, but who knows. Okay, so going back to more structuring, what else would you like to say about that?
Kent for years and his people for years have given this definition of structuring. Structuring requires two or more transactions, each of $10,000 or less, in one day that total more than $10,000. As far as I know, they have never given an authority for that definition, and I propose it's false. If you look at the law and the regulations themselves, which I recently cited and was published by the Monroe Journal, which was mentioned earlier. One transaction in one day intended to evade the bank reporting rule can constitute structuring. And that is what Kent was charged with 45 times. And what Kent is cleverly trying to do in promoting his false legal narrative is claim that's not the correct application of the law. Why it's not the correct application of the law, he's still keeping secret even after all these years. And he claims he has a team of people working to show how he'd been done wrong and how all of that was wrong. But he's keeping it under wraps for some strange reason.
Mm-hmm. The big picture here, again, this is the way I see it, and tell me if this is wrong or not. Basically, he's got this ministry going. He wants to pay some workers, but he doesn't want to record it and let the government know. So basically, in order to pay them, he takes withdrawals from the bank of cash, and that way there's no paper trail. And he knows that if it's over $10,000, the bank is going to report that, so he thought he'd take out a little bit less than $10,000, so it wouldn't trigger those alarms, but somebody's monitoring things, and they know that the structuring is going on. They can see this activity, right? So
right.
I guess when it comes down to questioning him, what's with this money? What are you doing with all this money? It's kind of obvious. What are you doing with this money? You're paying people, and why aren't you tracking it? Why aren't you reporting it, right?
Yeah, you're running $1 million through your bank account, and you're not filing tax returns. That kind of all fits together.
Right.
But let me back you up just a minute here. You said he was running a ministry.
Yeah.
For tax purposes, he was running a business. What he was doing was not operating as a church, and he was not operating otherwise as a ministry, as far as that term might be understood in law. He thought he was above complying with any laws as far as having any recognition by the government as to a religious organization that might have certain benefits. You know, he thought he could just say it. It's a ministry or it's a church, and that was good enough, and it's not.
Well, I partly agree and disagree with you. I agree with you that it is not a church, and it would be a scam to call what he does as a church, because as we both know, when I was a Christian, I was looking at forming a church, and so I looked into the laws and rules and stuff. We both know there's certain criteria you have to make to be a church, and for example, you have to have a creed, and you have to have regular meetings and stuff like that, and the IRS is familiar with people who try to hide money and funnel money and say, oh, it's a church, so keep out of my business. And if you're a church, you don't have to disclose so much. But, so I agree with you, there is no way he had a bona fide church. But I think one thing I would disagree with you is that you could obviously call it a ministry. I mean, if he actually documented things, he would be fine, like his son Eric is doing. He could have a 501c3 non-denominational ministry. It helps. It preaches the gospel, like he says. It teaches evolution, like he says. You can do all this stuff. You can draw a salary, everything, nonprofit, and he wouldn't have a problem.
Now, here's the difference. I think you're probably aware of it, but may need to be clarified. Eric applied to the government for recognition under 501c3.
Right.
And was recognized.
Right.
Kent did not.
Right. He didn't, but I'm saying he could. I mean, that's the problem. He didn't. If he did,
well,
it's a ministry. But I mean, he's operating. He thinks he can operate in the shadows like a church, because a church has all these. They can get away with this murder stuff.
I don't have a problem with him calling it a ministry, but he uses that term misleadingly for advantage, in trying to get people to think he was entitled to some kind of special benefit under the law.
Well, he was operating a ministry, but he wasn't operating it according to the law. I mean, like, anybody can do something stupid. I could build the car and put it on the road and say, look, it's my car, but I'll get a ticket and say, you know, they can tell me, look, this is not meeting the rules. You have to have a horn, you have to have this, you have to have blinkers, you have to have all these things, and maybe even crash test it. So I could just be stupid and say, like, hey, it's a car, but you're not allowed to put a car on the road unless you meet all the rules. And so he had a ministry, but he didn't follow the rules. And the reason why he didn't follow the rules is because he was trying to pretend like he didn't have to, because he's trying to pretend he was a church, because churches don't have to follow all these rules.
As far as any tax benefits that might be applicable to a 501c3 ministry, Kent was not qualified. He can call it whatever. He can call it a ministry. But when he uses that term to suggest under the law he was entitled to some benefit, he's lying about it.
Right. Because, I mean, he basically did not set it up correctly. He wasn't doing it correctly. And he knows that, and that's why he was dealing in cash. I mean, he was obviously...
And he tries to claim he didn't have to.
But check this out, though. If he really did have a church, if he really did have followers that met every week and they had their own creed and all that stuff, he could likely get away with all the crap he got away with, right?
Well, a lot of it. I think one of the things Peter J. Riley has emphasized in some of his articles, that if Kent Hovind had been conventionally compliant, like Eric seems to be, he would not have owed near as much money and probably wouldn't have had the need to be prosecuted for his criminal conduct. He might not have been such a criminal to have been prosecuted.
Yeah.
But because he had these sovereign citizen notions and how he was exempt from the laws and all this sort of thing, he developed a worst-case scenario, and it played out to his detriment, or he might think it's a plus now, or at least preach it's a plus, because he's out and going to be bigger and better than ever.
You know, I got to tell you, the thing that really kind of just seems so idiotic to me is, you know, if he says, look, I'm not a citizen of the United States, I revoke my Social Security number, I revoke everything, I am a citizen of heaven, I am not a citizen of the United States. It's like, he doesn't understand what he's saying, because he's getting all the protection and everything from the United States. If he really wanted to revoke everything, move out somewhere else, move out to, you know, some other country or something, and he'll find out. He's got to supply his own security forces. He's got to supply everything. So, I mean, it's so idiotic, stupid to say, I revoke my citizenship, and then you're still living as a citizen and getting everything from America.
Well, there's lots of issues tied up in that and different ways to approach it if Kent were ever to come out and seriously address it. It might be helpful to have him publicly, if it's still his position, to come out and confirm that, yes, I revoke my Social Security number, and I stand by revoking it, even though legally he probably didn't do that, can't do it. And he's welcome to say he's not a citizen of the United States. Where that might be an issue regarding his relationship to the government, we have a way of resolving that dispute, and it's not relying on Kent's claims. Like the income tax thing, Kent can claim whatever he wants regarding his views about the income tax law, and I think he needs to do it so people know really where he's coming from. But the IRS looked at his records, determined he owed the tax, gave him a chance to go to court. He went to court, he lost, he went to the appeals court, and he lost, and that issue's been resolved as far as the current standing in our legal system. Kent Hovind was subject to our personal income tax laws, and the record showed he owed a lot of income tax, and they assessed it against him, and he doesn't like talking about it.
Okay, so we're going to finish this section. Is there anything that you forgot that you wanted to say to tidy up the section so we can move on to the next section?
I can't think of anything offhand. Like I indicated earlier, I'm not very good extemporaneously. I prefer written exchanges, but I try to do what I can. And certainly maybe after the broadcast, we'll get some discussion from people that watch it.
Okay,
and I can respond further to specifics.
Okay, so this next session, I had 10 minutes each for this, and we're running out a little bit low on time now, so we'll shorten up a little bit. This one is called, Was Hovind Retired and Did He Claim It? What's this claim all about?
Well, I think I did hear him try to claim he was retired, but I don't know if anybody believed that. He certainly doesn't give the appearance of being retired now. He's going...
You mean, is this the reason why he said he didn't need to pay taxes, is because he retired? Is that what that relates to?
No, that doesn't have anything to do with it. I don't know what the deal was. Back then, he was not doing quite as much as he's doing now.
This is points 20 and 26. Do you have those of your points?
Let's see. Pull something up here real quick. Those are in my propositions. Let me see if I can find them real quick here. Here they come. Proposition 20.
20 and 26.
Well, 20 I have dealing with the master file information. 26, oh, I can't hold on them retired and live in a pastoral home. Yeah, he said that and I denied it. I think even now he probably wouldn't really claim to be retired, and I don't think he was back then. And it wasn't a pastoral home. It was a home that belonged to God Quest Incorporated. Who knows what the real details there are as to how he came to be allowed to live there the short time he was allowed to do so. That's a controversy in itself between him and Eric, who is the owner of God Quest Incorporated.
Yeah, I didn't understand even how... So when Kent owed all this money to the court and he couldn't pay it or didn't pay it, they confiscated his property, and apparently Eric, his son, bought some of the property. I'm surprised they even allow that, because it seems like it's entwined.
Well, I guess if you're a high bidder, you're a high bidder. I think the way it turned out is the court, before his personal income tax liabilities were resolved, just based on his convictions and past behavior, the court, mostly from structuring, the court determined he owed several hundred thousand dollars, which he could have paid. But he said, I'm not going to pay that. I probably didn't have the money offhand just to pay it. So the court said, okay, you got lots of property out there in Pensacola. We'll take the property.
Property was in Kent Hovind's name?
Yeah, it was in various nominee names that he used to try and hide it and keep the government away from it. But the government wound up having that property forfeited to the government, and then they started selling it off, and Eric and Andrew and Marlissa, I think all three of them, bought up some of the property, including Eric's God Quest Incorporated. And so that included the home.
Yeah, and Eric probably got the money. So, yeah, if God Quest bought it, that means his ministry probably bought it, so he just had donors basically come to the aid there to buy it.
Right, he raised the money some way or another, and Kent's people, I think, claim that the money raised to buy that house, in particular the one Kent had lived in, was provided by Kent's people, and therefore Eric ought to just turn over the keys to the house to Kent now, being a nice guy that he is. Doesn't work that way in real life, but Kent's people seem to think it should.
But you know, if he did that, the government would probably just take it because Kent owes him money, right?
Well, I would like to think the government's sharp enough to know that if Kent winds up with any substantive property, they'd be right on top of it. And Kent is working real hard to make sure that doesn't happen.
I don't know how you could fight that. That's like if you owe child support or whatever, they'll garnish your wages. I mean, it seems to me
that's why Kent
that kind of stuff
now is using these nominee organizations to do his business. So he's living well and making lots of money, and as far as the government's concerned, he doesn't make hardly anything because it's all funneled through these other organizations. Whether that's on the up and up or not, something for the government to try and figure out.
It looks like, I watched some of his videos, it looks like he's living in a camper on this dinosaur adventureland he's developing now.
Well, they've got all sorts of building projects going on at the property there. One of them includes a house they moved into the property and are remodeling.
Okay.
He's also got the campers and bunkhouses and other things, and who knows what he's going to wind up with when it's all over with.
So were you claiming then that Hovind, actually Kent Hovind said that he was retired when he had that so-called ministry? Was that part of his defense at one point, or was that he was retired?
No, it's just that at one point since he's been out of jail, I noticed that he had made the claim, I'm retired and I live in a pastoral home. I don't think that was true. It's just another in that's probably not one of the major points in the 62, but I'd like to, if we got that far in the list of propositions, I'd like to see him address that, what he was talking about.
Okay. Is there anything else you want to talk about this issue, or ready to go on to the next one?
Oh, I'm ready to move on if you'd like to.
Okay, so this next...
I don't think too quick on my feet, so I have to let you lead the way here.
Okay, I'll try to think for both of us, on both of our feet. So this next section is, did Hovind pray, in other words, by threatening an IRS agent? I put down here as your point 24 and 30. What's the accusation there?
Well, Kent and his people have, I think this is another one of the what I have come to call lies. Let's see, you said 24 and 30. 24, Judge Margaret Casey Rogers gave Kent Hovind 3 years for obstruction because he prayed for the investigating agents. That's something Kent has claimed.
Yeah, so Kent is basically saying, hey, I'm just praying for these people involved, and they are persecuting me for that. They are, giving them extra jail time or something?
Well, let me go through 330 here, too. He says, Ken Holbein says he spent 3 years in prison, he believes, for praying for the government agents. And then he says, supposed government agents. Again, going back to his idea that this isn't a real government, these aren't really government agents, that came after him for saying, God, they came after me, you fix it, Lord. The indictment includes a charge for obstruction. Mm-hmm. And the obstruction charge includes all sorts of things he did, which were considered by the grand jury to contribute to obstructing the investigation.
Like what, for example?
Let me just read some of them off to you. Destroying records, filing a petition for bankruptcy, and falsely listing the IRS as his only creditor for the sole purpose of discharging this debt and forcing the IRS to release seized property.
Wait, let's back up a little bit. Destroying records, he was accused of destroying records, you're saying?
Yes.
So basically they say, like, how much money did you make last year? And he's like, I don't know. I don't have that information, kind of thing like that?
I have to look up the details, but I don't think there's any question but what he destroyed financial records as part of his effort to keep anybody from finding out what he was doing. Another one is filing false and frivolous lawsuits against the IRS and other people involved. Filing a complaint.
Is there an example of what that is, the false?
Well, one of the ones I have repeatedly referred to is one he and Eric, his son, filed, alleging that Eric's wife, who was pregnant at the time, was put at risk, endangered, as well as her unborn child, when Scott Snyder came by one day to give Eric a summons. Eric wasn't there. He talked briefly with Eric's wife and left the summons with her. Kent and Eric filed a petition in federal court saying that the agent put Eric's wife at risk. That's one example, but there
is
were
that, is that like was that is that different than saying like that's a different claim than like there was a SWAT team that came in or there was a gun pointed at her or anything like that? Something
right, those are separate issues. All this was just, you know, a casual meeting because Eric was not at home,
so it was just stressful for his wife and it could have caused a miscarriage.
Well, they, as far as I know, they never gave an account to answer for that charge. I consider it one of the frivolous lawsuits they filed. It never went anywhere.
Okay, it was just dismissed, basically?
Right. And I don't know that Eric or Kent have ever given an account as to what that was all about, other than a frivolous filing.
So this is the Donald Trump technique where somebody sues you or whatever, and you hit them back 10 times as hard. So if the government's going to sue you, then you go after them and say, I'm suing you back for a lot of made-up things.
Well, that's what sovereign citizens are famous for. That's why they call them paper terrorists. They like to file a lot of paper and make a lot of frivolous claims, if nothing else, to bog down the system. And Kent was very good at doing that. And that was just one example I like to cite. The other one is making threats of harm to those investigating him and to those who may consider cooperating with their investigations. That's the one that gets into the prayer issue, which was considered at trial.
So basically, they're accusing Kent of praying like, "Go get him, God!" Like, I'll have revenge on you because I'm going to send God to take care of you, kind of thing. I mean, that's what
you might be aware that terrorists of all stripes use that kind of code language to send messages to their people. Now, Kent knows that when he says, "God, I wish you'd go out and do something about this," that God uses agents, and the agents are the people that might be sympathetic to Kent. There's all different ways to look at that. But let me read you something from the trial transcript that explains a little bit more about the prayer issue.
Okay, and then we're going to have to kind of close on that because we're out of time. So,
okay. Well, let me say this first, then. If we have time, I'll go back and read this. But
okay.
The 3 years Kent got for obstruction were concurrent with the 10 years he got on the other charges. So it really doesn't matter.
Okay.
One way or the other. Kent had
concurrent means they're running at the same time, so it was additional jail time supposedly, but it's running in parallel, so it's really no net effect, you're saying?
Right. He could have been acquitted of obstruction, and he still had got a 10-year sentence.
Yeah.
And you can even eliminate the prayer issue from the indictment, and there was still plenty there to convict him of obstruction. He's just, again, I think he's lying about the prayer issue. And if you want the details, somebody needs to go pull up the program where he said certain things that gave rise to that issue and the investigation.
Okay.
But let me read this if you still got time. The prosecutor, in her closing arguments, said Kent's lawyer claimed that the testimony was that when Mr. Hovind said that he was praying for these witnesses, these agents, that was the threat. That wasn't a threat. The threat was when he said, "And I know God knows how to take care of people who interfere with his ministries. You heard it on the tape, on the Truth Radio program, when he said it would be okay with him if God dealt harshly with the agents who served a lawful search warrant on his premises."
And then so one of his followers can say, like, "Hey, okay, I'll do something, and Hovind would be happy with me."
Right. And okay. And consider today's environment with all that's going on with these people.
Yeah, like some Christians shooting abortion doctors and stuff.
Right. And the Baton Rouge killer, cop killer, was apparently a member of a sovereign citizen organization. The terrorists in Nice and Europe and elsewhere in America.
Okay.
These are the types of things that are taken a lot more seriously now than they were then. And they were taken seriously then. But you need to put it in context if you want to talk about it.
Okay.
It didn't add 3 years to Kent's sentence, and it was only one factor in 8 or 9 or 10 that went to the obstruction charge.
Okay. Well, thanks, Robert Baty, for being on the show today. We talked about Kent Hovind, a Young Earth Creationist who's also a Young Earth Evangelist, a creationist, and an evangelist, and he served 10 years or so in prison, and he still has ongoing issues, and we think he's falsely accusing the USA of persecuting him. So Robert Baty is online, on websites, Facebook, to try to give another side of the story. So thanks, Robert, for being on the show.
Thank you.